OTEP family, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Well, you cannot get enough joy in your life, right? We know about some joys that have been on this show, but this is another level of joy. It's orange joy. It's Dr. Joi Lewis. She's the founder of Joi Unlimited, a coaching and consulting firm specializing in conflict, crisis, and change management. The firm is in the business of transformation of self and systems through a theoretical framework of the orange method. We're going to find out what that is. I came to know Dr. Joi Lewis by our good friend Resma Minicum, as you know, the Mr. Trauma, and Mr. Trauma and No Drama. And
that's so right.
My queen and I were watching a video that Resma had produced, and Dr. Joi had made an appearance on that. And I said, okay, the family needs to know who you are. So here you are. Welcome, Dr. Joi Lewis.
Thank you. Thank you. Hello. Hello. Hello, everyone.
So let's start out first with what is the Joi method, and how did you produce this, and a plethora of questions, but why did you produce the Joi method, and what is the significance of the color orange?
Yeah. Thank you for asking. So the orange method is a process, certainly not a destination, but it's a process, a framework in which we can use to be able to really get us on a journey and a pathway around healing, using radical self-care as a tool. So it has four parts. The first is meditation, which is about getting grounded. Mindfulness, which is about getting present. Emotional liberation, which is about getting free. And conscious movement, which is about getting unstuck. The orange, when you talk about meditation, you talk about mindfulness. So these are processes that are centuries old, right? So I didn't create the process of meditation and mindfulness. However, the orange method is about bringing those things together. I chose the color orange for a variety of different reasons. As we were connecting right before we went live, I'm originally from East St. Louis, Illinois, right? Not to be confused with St. Louis, Missouri, as I tell people they need to bow.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a difference.
You need to bow. I'm definitely from East St. Louis.
Don't walk up on the sister at night or in the daytime without introducing yourself. That's all I'm saying.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't want to be from anywhere else. But when I was growing up in East St. Louis, we had two high schools. East St. Louis Senior High School and Lincoln Senior High School. And both of their colors were orange and black and orange and blue. So you could never be on the wrong side, right? If you had on orange. So so I developed a love for orange as a young person because we were very much into supporting our teams. You know, I was the basketball player, you know, was very much into that. So that's where it started. And I kind of put it aside for a little bit whenever I was in college, but then I was drawn back to the color. And whenever I started doing work around healing and practicing yoga and doing comedic yoga, and then I learned that I started doing work around the chakras. And the chakra color for orange is the chakra that is right beneath your belly button, where transformation and life and all of those things happen. And so it seemed apropos as I was-
That was an aha moment for you too.
Yeah, I was like, oh, okay. This makes a lot of sense. Yeah. That is where the orange method came from.
Fantastic. Now you're an educator by
training. I am. Yeah.
And your thesis was on education, and now your dissertation was on I love the title, From Mammies, Maids, and Martyrs to Agents, Activists, and Authors: The Roles Black Women Play in Transforming the Academy in the U.S. and South Africa to Your Healing Today. Wow, that was huge. How did all of that come about in terms of your healing? How long ago was, because you've been obviously going through this transformation for some time.
For a long time, right.
Yeah, you just happened to codify and say, you know what, I think I'm going to give this to the public and teach this on a large scale. But you did this work first yourself.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, so I spent almost 25 years in the academy as a dean, vice president, chief diversity officer, a variety of different places. And, you know, I mean, it is the higher ed industrial complex. And so let us not be confused. And
that's, you know, called the plantation family. That's another term for it.
And, you know, in higher ed, it is producing what it's designed to do. It is not a democracy. We confuse it for a democracy because there have been so many different movements that have happened on campuses, but it's not a democracy. It's set up to keep the status quo in place, and it's doing a great job. And so, you know, it is doing a fantastic job.
Unfortunately, yeah, right.
Right. So I was in the, and I'm fortunate.
I would need you more than ever right now. Exactly.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And I'm, you know, I was fortunate. I met so many wonderful people there, particularly students, lots of folks who I have, stayed connected with, and I became politicized on campus. You know, like, you know, as I started learning about really the plight of what was happening, and then my outlook and how I shifted. So I'm thankful for that time. But as I continued to move, I spent most of my time as an administrator, also taught, but I was mostly an administrator. And as I continued to move up the ranks, I started to notice how Black women were moving through higher ed. And I was like, but wait a minute. What I wanted to study, like, does it matter what your role and rank is, right? So I interviewed senior faculty presidents, vice presidents of institutions in the U.S. and in South Africa. Mm-hmm. And my title for Mammies, Maids, and Martyrs, it was like, it really, what I learned is like, it doesn't really matter what your title is. They still want us to do the cleanup work. Right. They still want us to be the mammy, to take care of them, to do, it doesn't really matter, you know? And so unfortunately, I mean, that's what my hypothesis was, and it was true. And I, both from my experience of interviewing folks, and then from my own lived experience as I became a dean, vice president in my last position, at a Minneapolis Community and Technical College, and I was there for 9 months, you know, long enough to birth getting out of there. The students were amazing, but the racism was really horrific. And so all of that to say, but it was in that sort of incubator of being inside the academy and seeing really the sort of the disconnect between what was happening in the academy and what was happening in our communities, and sort of that wall. I mean, again, I'm from East St. Louis, you know, and so it's like just seeing like what the reality of, particularly of Black people were and are, and just this the difference between you. I know. I mean, I grew up around some of the most brilliant people. I think of my grandmother. You know, she was. She, you know, as I always say, she had a fourth grade education. She had a PhD in wisdom, you know. I didn't know anybody smarter than her. But as I look at, like, who gets the opportunities, the neighborhood that we live in now, you know, to look at the young people, what they're trying to, what they're having to navigate. And it's not about intelligence, right? It's about how the resources get distributed, the kind of trauma that both that we are experiencing now, right, in real time, and the historical trauma that has lived in our bodies. And I've seen that show up in my own body, right? So as I lived in Minnesota for 10 years, from 97 to 2007, spent some time in South Africa, and then I was out in Oakland, California, as dean and vice president of small women's college, Mills College in Oakland. And I thought I moved there to... for a job, but I realized that I moved there for my own healing process.
What happened in Oakland?
So when I moved to Oakland, I had been most of my adult life, I had been at least 120, 130 pounds overweight. Mm-hmm. And I moved to Oakland. I got connected to a recovery community there. a food recovery, which is just, you know, it's a 12-step program, much like Alcoholics Anonymous, but for food. And, you know, I walked into the room. I had heard of it here in Minnesota, but when I went, it was like mostly white. And then I went to California and I walked in this room and it's like 100 people, and like 70% of the folks up in there are Black women. And I was like,
wow,
where have I landed? And I had a sponsor who was just amazing. I talked to for every day for like 3.5 years. And I say was because she passed away. She had lung cancer and had never smoked, right? But just, you know, again, how the trauma shows up. But through that process, not only recovery, I got introduced to a meditation process, to yoga, to what I really realized it was less about what I was eating, what was eating me, and the way that racism and sexism, and homophobia, all these things, you know, show up in and on our bodies, and began to do that healing work. And I moved back here to, as I said, take that position into some really deep racism and that I experienced. And that 120 pounds, 70 of those pounds found me again, right? Even my best, with my best efforts of like trying to eat well, trying to do, but the stress and how our bodies react to the trauma that is lodged, right, in our bodies. And the resentment, honestly, that I was really, you know, holding around issues of oppression and how they show up. And I still, you know, I do not, those things are not okay. I will always speak out against them. That said, what my book really talks about is how do we both cultivate joy and hold heartbreak at the same time, right? Mm-hmm. Because we have to have the, because joy and pain really run from the same faucet, right? And if we try to turn it off, try to turn off the pain, we also are missing out on the joy. And it's, you know, part of some of what, you know, Resma and I talk about all the time as well. It's just like, how do you cultivate that? So my work really has been about, I'm trying to help people to, even in the midst of, right, of all these things, how do we also know that we are a people who have amazing and joyous and things to be able to embrace? And how can we find joy even in the midst of all those things?
Well, see, and this is why I wanted to have a conversation with you, because trauma is a bee. I just want to put that out there. It's so insidious, and it morphs. It's like a, you know how those viruses in the computer, like those Trojan viruses, you put them in and they get in there and you get like, you know, McAfee or Norton, and you put it on there, and the virus literally runs, or the Trojan runs around from one place to the next, trying to, you know, so if it's like, if it won't affect your health, then it'll go to your relationship. If it don't go to the relationship, then it'll go to your work and money. And then it just starts to, so talk to us about how, because obviously there's various different types of trauma and we're bombarded with it. You know, I had Dr. William A. Smith on, who is the creator of Racial Battle Fatigue, did the research on that.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so we've got that constant bombardment that's on us. We've got our historical trauma. You know, we've got that epigenetic trauma that we come with. Then we have just the regular trauma of being a human being.
Sure. Right?
Then we have the trauma of being a melanated human being.
Right.
From childhood on. And so trauma is almost like, if trauma worked in the same rules as compound interest, we would all be multi-billionaires right now, right? So how did your trauma show up? And multiple levels and layers of trauma, how were you able to identify those different aspects of trauma? And then how did you, you know, in your methodology, because obviously you were your first client.
Yeah, no, that's real talk. You know, I mean, the first, you know, one of the first places that trauma showed up in my life pretty, really super, super early, my mom passed away when I was 7 months old, right? So, you know, that's what I call, you know, a God-sized hole, right? So, you know, I was 7 months. My brother was one and my sister was four. Mm. And my parents were 28 years old, right? Mm. And so that's trauma, right? That's just
yes,
trauma.
Yes, yes.
And she passed away of cancer. And, you know, even to this day, you know, there's the lawsuit that hasn't yielded really what it should. But our East St. Louis is right next door to the Monsanto plant, right? Uh-huh. It's in a made up city. They created a city so they wouldn't have to pay taxes, right, to East St. Louis. So it's called Sauget, Illinois, but you know, it's really East St. Louis.
Okay.
So the fumes, so lots of environmental, you know, effects. I believe that you know, part of my mom's illness was from that. And so there, you know, so it's this sort of compound, and you don't even really understand what's going on, right? Like, and later on, but it's like what seems like an individual thing, right? It's really systemic. Right. So even like, yes, the tragedy of me losing my mom. And it's like, okay, was she, you know, she was a nurse. She had been healthy, mm-hmm. you know? So that kind of thing. And then, you know, so my dad, she had my dad to promise her two things: that he would not let anyone else raise us, and that he had to finish school. So he was working at the Chrysler plant at the time, and he was also in college studying social work. And so he did both of those things. There we sat at his, you know, graduation. My father just passed away quite a year ago. It'll be a year in May. So I start there with that very early piece, because what did that develop in me? What that did, yes, I had a wonderful extended family. You know, we're really blessed, had grandmothers, and, you know, but I didn't have my mother, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so, you know, I tell the story actually in my book that it wasn't until 15 years ago, my niece just turned 15, until 15 years ago, people would say, hey, you always are talking about your dad. Why don't you talk about your mom? And I said, you know, my mother passed away when I was 7 months old. And they were like, oh, I'm really sorry. And I would say, that's okay. I didn't know her. That's what I would say. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But then when my niece was born 15 years ago and I'm holding her, my sister and her family used to live here. I'm holding her and she says, she's crying. My sister leaves, goes to Target. And my niece is crying at the top of her lungs. And I'm like, what is the problem? You're fed? I'm holding you? What's going on? She kept screaming. My sister comes back. My niece was 5 months old. My sister comes back. She hears her voice and she stops crying. Right. And from that day on, I stopped saying I did not know my mother. I stopped saying that I did not know my mother.
Wow.
Because my niece taught me that I in fact did. Right.
How powerful is that? Wow.
Right. But when did I stop crying? When did I give up, right? It's where the Trump, when did I give up? Because she wasn't coming, my mom wasn't coming back from Target, right? Mm-hmm. She was gone. Mm-hmm. So something developed in me where I decided, okay, as a young one, okay, my mom is gone. So it's up to me. So there's I developed a lot of self-reliance, not only I didn't want anybody to do anything for me, but not only did I want nobody to do anything for me, but not for me, for my father, for my sister, for my brother, mm-hmm. I'm gonna take care of it all, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Which is part of like how Black folks in general, as we move around, you know, you think about like.
And particularly Black women.
And I was saying, and particularly Black women, what we are carried and what we're conditioned, and you take on all of that, right? Mm-hmm. And it has nowhere to go, you know? And so we often bury it in our bodies. We're carrying it on our shoulders, and it's just, you know, it's really, really pent up. So that's really how it showed up for me. And there's lots of patterns throughout, both in terms of my family developing, you know, a way of being around codependency, you know, and I was the kind of codependent that didn't even get credit, right? Because, you know, I was like, because people, nobody would, because of my demeanor, nobody would ever think that I was somebody who would allow someone, that I would move boundaries. But, you know, it's like you ask me, oh, well, you know, Joy, can I borrow $50? Well, I'm really like, look, you need to have your money together. Why are you asking me? You should, here's $100.
So you would get the lecture and a bonus. I mean, just damn. All right, Joy.
So they just like, oh, wow, we got to do is just listen to her. And then,
right.
Yeah. Right?
Wow.
And so in order to deal with that, for me, around the trauma, so you got just regular life stuff, like as you said, then being a Black woman, right, in this context, in the U.S., right, coming from East St. Louis, what I had to, like, go up against, all that trauma, all that racism, all that stuff you're carrying. So for me, my way of coping was through addiction, and my addiction, my drug of choice was food, which is not uncommon for Black women.
Let me put my hand up.
And we're rewarded for, you know, it's like, hey, you can throw down, you can do this, and it's a kind of slow, protracted death, right? It's a slow, protracted death, and you know, and it's a and it's, but it was like the best I could do to try to cope with, like, dealing with the world. And I was like, you know what, I'm killing myself. This doesn't make any sense. And so I have to, how do I shift this? And it's not an individual problem, because it definitely is systemic. And how do we talk about this and do this work? And so that's really, you know, kind of how it showed up for me. And then noticing and watching my people die, you know, and watching as I got really involved, a lot of my work over since I've left the academy, I have been very blessed to be to get to do lots of work in the community, particularly around healing from trauma. There, Minneapolis Foundation hired me right after Mike Brown had been murdered in Ferguson. Then I got a call, and it was like, well, you know, we don't want to be the next Ferguson. Right. That kind of thing. And it's like, okay. And they're like, you know, will you convene a group of folks from the mayor's office, the police, NAACP, Black Lives Matter? And there was a group called Neighborhoods Organizing for Change, which was a Black-led organization. And I said, okay, well, what do you want to happen? And they said, well, we want to prevent a civic uprising. I said, I can't
do
that.
In the situation. Wow.
Yeah, I can't do that. But what I can do,
you're a superwoman. You know,
but because you're Black, you're
the cleanup woman.
Yeah, I can't do that. And I said, and if I could, I wouldn't.
Right, exactly.
But what I can do is get these, like, seemingly disparate groups in the room together to build some authentic relationships. Because, you know, as we move through, and people are like, oh, so Dr. Joy, you're neutral. I said, no, I'm not actually not neutral. I stand on the side of justice. I stand on the side of liberation. I'm always going to be on that side. And if we can move through. So we did. They asked me to do it for, to convene this group for a year. And I said, no, I won't do a year. I'll do 3 months. Because if we sign up for a year, people gonna have come, they're gonna be on their phone. I know how that rodeo ends now. Mm-hmm. We're gonna come, we're gonna get concentrated. We did that. We did that work. And after 3 months, and you can imagine, people weren't too excited about coming to the table. Different groups. But we did that work. And at the end of that work, they said, they went to the Minneapolis Foundation, said, we need to continue this work. And as a matter of fact, we love to do an overnight retreat. I was like, okay. And they were like, you know, but we really want Dr. Joi to facilitate. And so the foundation agreed. 3 days later, Jamar Clark was murdered in Minneapolis. And there was a takeover of the police station for 18 days occupation in the winter. And so on and so on, right? And so then we had Philando Castile to get, you know, so on and on. And I say all of that to say that, so I began to work, do this work more deeply with folks who were on the front lines and noticing, you know, our activists, the folks who are speaking out, they were really struggling, having a lot of suicidal ideations, not being able to get up, you know, they're on the microphone, you know, in the morning, by night, they're paralyzed and can't move. And so this is what's really real, that, you know, we're fighting for justice and fighting for the collective, and people are dying individual slow deaths. And these are things that we, and this is what the work is about. How can we really be on a pathway to healing, not as something we get to if we get a chance, but how does this become, and this is why it's radical, right? Like,
well, I was gonna say, this is absolute radical self-care.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Now, you know, what I love about your work, from what I've been, you know, looking at online and hearing about you, I mean, you have yelling sessions.
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is like, you know, this is the stuff, okay, family, this is for us, okay? This is our stuff. This is what we need to get this stuff out. Because as we all know, trauma is stored in the body, not in the mind. It manifests as cognitive biases in the mind, but it is stored in the body, and
that's,
it's
right,
reflexive. And there are things that we need to do to get that stuff out of there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and a colonic ain't gonna cut it. You know, it's just not enough. And
it's important.
It's important. Yeah, I don't want to make that, you know, want to make that distinction. But talk to me about some of these radical things that you do, because you do comedic yoga. Vinyasa yoga. You're a teacher as well.
Yeah.
So you do all of these kind of, almost a yin and a yang approach to healing. So it's not just, you know, namaste, namasta. It's like, I'm getting in here and we're going to get this stuff out.
Yeah, we have to, right? There's not, you know, I talked to folks, you know, I was on a podcast the other day and we were gathering. It was called Living Your Best Black Life.
I love that.
The young people got it together.
Like, let's take it over to the next level. It's like, no. I'm like my best black life. Right.
And so I said, you know, how often do you think we should cry? How often do you think? What do you think? What do you think, Brother Philippe? How often do you think we should cry?
Figuratively or literally, I mean, I'm tearing up every day.
Yeah.
Because what it does for me, and you know, I have come to this within the last probably about a year and a half, 2 years. It's just cleansing. It's like, I gotta let this, pardon my French, SHIT go.
Absolutely.
And I don't want Wolf Blitzer down here, and I don't want to be on CNN in that manner, in that way. You know what I'm saying? Because it'll make you lose your damn mind. And the other thing, because I take on this work of interviewing and healing my family historically and bringing all this information, so I'm constantly in it vicariously, as well as
secondary trauma.
So I've got to let this thing. Now, I joke with people on the air. At the end of the very day, I have a good cigar, and I have a nice scotch or whatever the spirit is, not to the point where I'm inebriated or anything, but that's just my self-time, and I'm contemplating, taking my notes, and, you know, puffing on my cigar. And now, the funny thing is, and you can relate to this as a trauma expert, so my queen is a nurse and has been for like 40 years, and so I have asthma, and developed asthma when I came to Sacramento from Chicago.
Okay.
Didn't know I had it. but started smoking cigars, and the doctors are saying, "Are you? How is it that you have no blood pressure? You're healthy as a bull. Your lungs are clear. How do you have asthma and you smoke cigars?" I said, "Well, I smoke cigars to keep the crime rate down in Sacramento. First of all, let's just keep that in
on the
yeah." Okay, because if you hear anything happening in Sacramento, it means Felipe ain't had a cigar. That's all that means right there. Right. And so my baby, I said, how is it that I smoke cigars and I don't have these things? She says, because it's the mechanism that's keeping you alive. It's like, it's a way that, you know, everybody has some of these secondary gains, if you will.
And
it's not a health, it's a maladaptive, you know, situation.
Sure.
But, you know, we all know, Big Mama smokes cigarettes every day, all day, and everybody else is dropping dead. That's, you know, running marathons, and it's like, you know, how is that possible? The way that coping mechanism has been coded in their bodies.
That's right.
So, long story short, yeah, I'm tearing up all the damn time. I'm crying all the time. I'll be crying after this show. You know, I'm just gonna let it go.
Or doing is fine.
You're right, doing is fine too. That's right. Just don't say that. Don't do no. Don't put me in an Oprah situation on a show. You know, it's embarrassing. Is what it is, Joi.
It's beautiful. It's human. It's good stuff.
So a lot of us think that crying is bad. We got to hold it in, and it's like, well, all you're doing is compounding that trauma. That's like a cancer.
That's right. Yeah, I mean, and that's the thing. And what I tell folks is like, at least once a day. And I'm not talking about that cute crying.
I hear that for the first time.
Yeah. You know, they're like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, and I say, you know, not that cute cry, you know, with a little tear. I mean, that's nice. But I'm talking about the ugly cry.
The Viola Davis or Oprah 1986 cry.
Yeah. you're like that. Yeah. Because there's no way for you to be able to cry like that and not feel better.
So you're just
gonna feel better. Now you might not feel good.
Right.
But you will feel better.
Right.
I didn't say you were gonna feel good. You are gonna feel better.
And I love you. You're just awesome.
You know, and sometimes that feeling better is not about maybe it's just the fact that you're able to feel, right? Yeah. So you might feel sadness more. You might feel hurt more, but you actually can feel, right? And that is beautiful. It's human, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And I know for all the time that I would use my addiction to not feel, right? Mm-hmm. So let me stuff so I don't actually feel. Mm-hmm. So when I'm not going for it, I feel better. But like I said, sometimes I feel some stuff that, you know, mm-hmm. I wasn't
accustomed to.
Yeah, I'm like, oh. But it will pass, right? Yeah. It will pass, and you learn how to understand. And we get to have a variety, a range of emotions, right? Mm-hmm. And start like seeing like, oh, how does that feel? It's more textured. It's more, you know, because really, particularly as Black folks, we have been either the expectation is that we're superhuman or we're subhuman, but that we never get to actually be human.
Wow.
And so taking away our ability and our privilege of actually connecting with our emotions and our feelings is to crush our humanity. Wow. So this is about reconnecting to our humanity and others, right? And that's a beautiful thing. The human process is, it's not, you know, it's like I said, it doesn't always feel good.
Uh-huh.
But we realize that we have the capacity, right? It was smart. It was smart of us to, brilliant actually, to have to like shut down a lot of things so we could get through. It was so smart.
Yeah.
And it helped us survive, and we had to get through. But today, we have a broader range of tools and practices that are available to us, and so we're not limited to just those things that shut us down, that create harm, that we can add and reclaim. And again, these things are not new. So, you know, one of the things that I talk about is, go with me for a moment. Just take your right hand and just put it over your heart. Mm-hmm. Right. Have this hand over heart meditation. Right. And when you take your hand, there's so much power in our own hands. Our whole central nervous system will begin to just come. Mm. And you can take that and you can just take a deep breath in. Go ahead and let it out. Just hold that, feel that. And I think back to, you can keep holding your heart if you want, or you can let it go. I think back to my grandmother. My grandmother would always put her hand over her heart. You know, it was nothing that we ever talked about, but now I know what it does, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, so these things are not new, right? We're getting language to them, or you know, they've been available to us. But it's like we have this healing power that is in our own hand and is touching, and we don't get touched in loving, kind ways enough, right? And the power of touch, the power of being gentle with ourselves, being gentle with each other. So when people think about healing, you know, and I think I was talking about this, you know, with Brother Reza, when you think about healing, you know, folks often want to think that that's like some like cute process. Healing is not cute.
I remember that. That was very brilliantly said. It's not. Self-discovery is messy.
It's not. It ain't cute. And it hurts, you know? Mm-hmm. And as I said, you know, when I was spraying my
analogy on that piece too, you were talking about like the scab and the alcohol. Run us through.
You know what I mean? My grandmother would say, you know, old school, I'm like, I sprayed my knee. And she's like, okay, baby, come here. You know, and then she'd get out that alcohol. And she would pour that alcohol in that wound. Mm-hmm. That stuff hurt.
No doubt.
Right?
No doubt.
It hurt. But it has to happen. Mm-hmm. Because we got to get all of that infection out of there. Right? And it's just like excruciating pain. But then if you can just stick with it, if you can just stick with it, then you start feeling some relief. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. You start feeling some relief. But you cannot just scrape your knee and put a Band-Aid over it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because now it's worse. Now you got all kind of infection that's coming there, ain't been cleaned out. And this, that's the thing, you know, and it's like the different levels. And when we're talking about, particularly as Black folks, and the kinds of the level, the deepness in which our scars are and what it takes to be able to get in there, a Band-Aid ain't going to do it.
Right.
Some other folks, you know, might be able to get by with that. We can't, that's not going to work, y'all. And so that's why, as you talked about, like the disease and how stuff shows up and it starts going around like that virus, right? So it's going to find somewhere to be. So it starts showing up in our communities. You know, shows up in so much. When we talk about violence, we often are talking about physical violence, and that certainly is a way that it shows up, but. Yeah. The violence that has been on our finances, the violence that is on our food, the violence, it's, there's so much, like the disease just like goes, and we have to do the kind of surgery, if you will, to really get in there and get at the root of what's happening. And you know what? What we just don't get enough of is the opportunity to just be met with the love, to be met with the love and kindness, to be gentle. I see you, you know, brother, how you doing? You know, that, and I mean, for that to be met when anger might be coming at me, for me not to be confused, right? So I get to both have a boundary and I also get to show up in love, right? Like that's actually not okay. And I still love you, bro, right? And it's, I still like, I'm still coming, and I'm not going to give up. We don't have to like give up together, right? But we need to have, you know, as I said, you got to have some screaming sessions. You know, we got to go to the wailing wall. Like, we got to get this stuff out, right? And laugh. laughing, you know, like deep belly laughs, right? Mm-hmm. Just because, hugging for a really long time. Right? Till you really uncomfortable.
It's an uncomfortable hug.
Right, that uncomfortable hug. Not sexually, just
right.
You know, just like somebody touching me, like it's like
right. You're holding me too long, bro. Yeah.
Right. You get to be held, to be listened to, you know, just giving people opportunities to. I do this mantra that I have folks when you know, you ask someone a question, and I say, so you know what, we can actually demonstrate. Why don't we just try this? So I'm going to ask you a question, and you, for this question that I'm asking you, I'm not, even if I like resonate with it, I'm not going to be like, yeah, that's cool, that happened to me. No, this is your time. You know, I'm just going to give you a minute, and then we'll switch, and you can ask me the same question. And well, my question, but here's the thing. While I'm listening to you, there are three things that I'm going to remember about you. That you are amazing, that you're awesome, and that you're brilliant. Mm. No matter what you're saying, I am not confused by that fact. Wow. Right? That you are amazing, awesome, and brilliant, right? Okay. And so whatever it is that you need to, you know, that you want to share, I'm just going to remember that. So I'm gonna set the timer for a minute, right?
Oh, Lord.
You can do it. And you got it. I'm gonna listen, but I'm not gonna be like, yeah, dude. I'm just gonna remember and hold the fact that you're amazing, awesome, and brilliant. Okay. So here's my question. What was your arrival story to get here today, right? So to show up for this call. Now look, that can start from a few minutes before you got on. It can be from this morning. It can be from when you were born. Like, it's your minute. So you get to use it however you like. And your time begins now.
Wow, my arrival story to this interview. So my nickname that I gave myself is a process that I use called SHOCK, and it stands for Seeking Higher Omnipotent Conscious or Cosmic Knowledge. And so I'm constantly seeking the highest level of knowledge, highest frequency, and highest vibration to heal what I went through in my childhood and in my adulthood. And the goal is always to develop a life, live a life in a way that a child doesn't have to go through what I went through coming up. So this is not a hobby for me. This is my assignment. You know, I believe that when spirit gives you, when you find your purpose, spirit, the universe, God, whatever you want to call it, gives you your assignment. And this is my assignment. And so I'm voracious with it because I'm looking at this from a standpoint of frequency. I'm taking in, is that my minute? My minute is up?
That's time. Yeah,
okay, finish time. Your time. Okay. Finish your time. Wow. I'm a talker too, by the way, in case you didn't know.
No, That's good.
Now, I can ask you the same question, and
I have to ask you the same question.
That you're amazing, awesome, and brilliant.
I'm amazing, awesome, and brilliant.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's not going to be hard to do. So that's I think everybody watching will agree. Yep, she is. All of those things and a few others. And I would say a bag of chips, but we don't want to. That might be a
chip. Right.
Yeah, we don't want that. Okay, so what brought you, Dr. Joi Lewis, what brought you to say yes to this interview today?
Yeah, thanks for the question. You know, I am, I am definitely at that point in my life where I'm clear about what my assignment is, what it is that I am supposed to be doing. And I am very serious about putting healing in the hands of anyone, anywhere, right? Particularly as I call all people my cousins, and I call it black people, my, you know, those are particularly my cousins. So I definitely want to make sure that I'm getting it to the cousins. And so, you know, an opportunity to get to have this conversation with you, to know that you're reaching so many folks, to make sure that I just want the message for people to know, like, it's okay, right? Like, whatever it is that you're, that's happening, whatever you're going, you get to heal, and we get to have this. When I wrote this book, boom, my time is up. That's good.
So
that's good.
I know, but now you were doing this as an exercise. I want you to finish codifying what that means in terms of each other.
So basically, it's like
these three things: awesome,
amazing, awesome, and brilliant. And you know what would life be like, right? So let me ask you. So me asking you the question, and then you knowing, right, that what I was going to remember was that you were amazing, awesome, and brilliant. How did that impact how you got there?
How did that land for me? Well, obviously, it's like I get to be really my authentic self because I'm going to be loved no matter what.
That's right.
I could have went to a very dark place. Mm-hmm. And regardless of that, I'm still awesome. Right. I'm still brilliant. And amazing. So, yeah. That is so powerful and liberating because we're in such self-shame and self-blame mode.
That's right.
And self-guilt mode.
Right.
That we don't share. We don't want to give it up. Right. And so I really appreciate that. Is that part of why you do this process?
Yeah, absolutely. And that the process, because again, I like whenever I'm with folks, to know, like, these are things that I want people to take with them, right? That they are not mine.
The chapter you have called "It's Not Your Fault."
It's not your fault. Yeah, it's not your fault.
And I don't think a lot of people have ever heard that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ever, particularly us.
Yeah.
If anything, it is our fault. And even in some of the, I do a lot of stuff in the metaphysical realm and space.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the old school metaphysics blames you. Well, you must have attracted this into your situation. So, you know, it's, you know, cause and effect. No. It's not my fault.
It's not your fault.
I'm not owning this.
No, it's not your fault.
Talk to us about that because we need to hear this.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. It's like, we didn't create this, you know? We didn't create this. I mean, the part that gets hard is I want people to know, like, this is not, and even when we're talking about radical self-care and healing, this is not yet another thing for you to put on your list. Something else for you to feel bad about.
Or another burden.
I'm
less than shit than I was prior to.
Exactly.
You know, because I've already been told I ain't shit by everybody.
Exactly.
Internally,
it's like, no.
Internally, you know, so I ain't no good, you know, yada, yada, yada. Yeah.
It's like, this is not something else for you to feel bad about. Mm-hmm. For that you haven't done X, Y, and Z, or if you don't do it. It's like, no. You know, I encourage people to just consider, I'm not saying you got to do it, but just consider being completely pleased with yourself.
Exactly
where you are.
Powerful.
And what would that look like? If you're just like, I'm all right, you know,
wow.
I'm just going to be pleased with myself. I'm not going to miss this moment because it's never going to happen again.
Mm-hmm.
So I might as well. And you know what? There are enough people out there who are not pleased with you. Let them have that job. That job is taken. Let them have that job.
You don't need to help them out.
They got that on lockdown, right?
Let them
have that job.
Co-sign on that.
How about you take on the job of being completely pleased with you? And to just, like, nothing to alter, nothing to change in this particular moment, right? Because cultivating that kind of, like, loving kindness and gentleness to ourselves will allow us to be in relationship and community with other folks.
Mm-hmm.
Where we can give grace, we can give love, but I can't give what I'm not giving to myself, right?
Mm-hmm.
I cannot pour from an empty cup. Like, it's not going to work. And so, You know, so we deal with the fact that we confront the fact that it's not our fault. That's where we start. Uh-huh. That said, if I want to heal, I do have to take some responsibility. Right? So that's the hard part to swallow. It's like, but I am in charge. And
fault are two different things.
That's right. That bears repeating.
Accountability and fault are two different things.
That's right.
It's not your fault, but you are accountable.
You know?
And can
because
be.
Yeah. Nobody else is going to show up. I have to show up on my own behalf. Uh-huh. And part of that is about me deciding, making a decision that I'm worth it.
Uh-huh.
Right? That I'm worth it. I'm worth showing up for. Right? So, and then there are small actions. My grandmother would say, it's the small foxes that destroy the vine, right? Mm. It's the little bitty things. We want to, do this. We want to go real big. It's like, just take a little extra breath. Mm-hmm. Just pause for a minute, you know? Just take a little time and put on, you know, as I have this poem, like, may lotion feel like essential oils, you know? Like, mm-hmm. Let this walk from the parking lot, to the grocery store. Let that count, right? Let that count as exercise. Like, let every little thing, like, be that meditation, right? It doesn't have to be, like, doesn't have to look in this really capitalized way that says, like, you know, you have to take care of yourself. You got to be at this gym, or you got to do this. You got to buy all the things. You got because again, radical self-care for me, the reason why I talk about it as being radical is because first of all, the system does not want us well. It wants us sick. It wants us disconnected. It wants us frustrated. It wants us down and out. Because if we are those things, then capitalism wins. Right? Uh-huh. We trying to buy the special cream. We trying to do the thing. We trying to make ourselves feel better. Uh-huh. We got to pay more medical bills. We're working more. And that's the whole point. But when self-care, I'm like, let self-care become primary care, right?
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. So if we start bringing that back, right?
Wow.
Then, and then the self-care that I talk about radical self-care, it is automatically situated in community, right? Uh-huh, uh-huh. This isn't about going off and being isolated. That's not what I'm talking about.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
But it's about saying, you were talking about like feeling, being filled up, you know, it's talking about like the energy bank, right? Like it's nothing wrong with having a withdrawal if there's some in the bank.
Uh-huh,
right?
Uh-huh. Nice.
But, you know, our emotional banks, our energy banks, our spiritual banks are empty. And so we writing a bunch of bad checks. And, you know, I mean, you know, I'm dating myself a little bit, but I used to know when those checks, when I can write this on today, and then, you know, it might not hit.
Right. Well, as Kevin Hart said, the way my banking is set up, you know, I have to write a check. I got to transfer the money. It takes about 4 days.
It's going to come. And then some days you get caught. You get caught.
That's right. Some days
you get caught. And then when you get caught, it's all bad. That $5 check now is costing me $35.
That's right.
And so that's what we're doing with our energy. Right? We're writing bad checks, y'all.
Yep.
And we're floating them and we're getting caught.
Right.
And now we're in resentment.
Wow. Nice.
And we're not taking care of ourselves. So
beautiful. Now another chapter you have, and I'm gonna let you go out after this, is Let Your Heart Break Open.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Talk to us about that. What does that mean?
Yeah, you know, one of my favorite poets, Rumi, who's a Persian poet, and he says, perhaps the heart keeps breaking so it'll stay open. Right? Mm-hmm. Perhaps that's why it keeps breaking, so it'll stay open, right? And, you know, I think about that. And here's the thing. There's a lot that's going on. It's heartbreaking. Uh-huh. It's heartbreaking. Uh-huh. But either we're going to let our hearts break or we're going to break down.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
We got a choice.
Uh-huh.
Because the, you know, because you can't, and the breakdown happens when we're like, we're keeping all that stuff in, we're stuffing it, we're not letting it process. But the breaking open is that we can look at it, we can notice it, we can actually feel it in our body. We can verbalize it, we can cry, shake, wail, scream, do what we gotta do, call up our people, be in community, say how this is really hard, and then it helps us to move through it, right? Mm-hmm. And it helps us to be more and more connected to our humanity. The more we try to block it off, the more, you know, we try to shut it down. That's why we keep breaking down, right?
Wow.
And what we want to do is just break open. Let it just break open.
Wow. It's the Orange Method family. OM, you know what that means?
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
So there's something to this. Dr. Joi Lewis, the website family is joiunlimited.com. Go there. She's got an amazing newsletter. She's got amazing resources, and you do need to get this book immediately. And you'll know it when you see it, because it's orange.
Right.
It's not a book that you're going to miss, you know. That's when you're scrolling in Amazon, all these books come up. Ooh, what's that? There she is.
It is orange. Love that.
You're so brilliant and genius in your branding. Now, you also do a lot of classes. Talk to us about your coaching and you do individual, you do group, you do corporate. What's the range? And for those people in East St. Louis or nearby, in my hometown, Chicago, come on down and get some joy. How can they do that?
Yeah. So I'm actually in St. Paul, Minnesota. But I have more and more, and there'll be even more offerings that are coming out for virtual offerings. We'll be having a course on radical self-care. Also, of course, it's focusing on freedom, freedom fighters, freedom for freedom fighters, right? So both in terms of, so the radical self-care is really helping people to either remind you or to help you to begin to incorporate in your daily life these practices. So we know the practices, but like, how are we a part of a community that is going to actually help us get these radical self practices in our lives, not as, again, as something just like cute to do, but to really transform your life so you can actually be free, you can show up, you can live your best life, and be connected, and be a part of the community, get out of isolation. Even though we have, you know, we have the internet, we have phones, we are more disconnected than we have ever been. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so this is really about getting to reconnect with yourself, reconnect with other folks. I also am very, very called to and doing work with folks who I call invisible emotional laborers, right? And those are the folks who are out there. They're doing the work. They're on the front line. They're taking care of folks. They're doing it. How do you actually monetize your emotional labor? I want people to be able to set your life up so you are giving out of your abundance. Both in terms of your financial abundance, your energy, your space, like how can we give from the overflow? So I want folks to know you can do well and do good, right? Because again, otherwise we write bad checks, y'all, and then we're resentment. So I would ask for folks to be looking for those opportunities. They'll be coming out next month or so. You can go to my website now, Joi, J-O-I, that's Joi with an I, unlimited.com, and you can sign up on our website for our newsletter and also to just stay connected so you'll know when things are happening. Also on social media at Dr. Joi Lewis, so you can find me on Instagram, you can find me on Facebook, you can find me on LinkedIn. And just dropping, you know, complimentary content of just like, hey, live your best life, take some breaths, be in community. And we also will be offering some opportunities around food prep. I'll say this, you know, as I am wrapping up, it just really amazes me how everything is like so brand new. Food prep is so old. Are y'all really trying to act like this is new? Are you serious? My grandmother, I mean, y'all think about your grandmamas, you think, we've been doing this, you know?
Yeah.
They had a deep freezer down in the basement. Come on. They had a whole family could come. You should go down there and get them two bags of greens, get that meat out. So, you know, it's reclaiming what we actually already know, that we need to create and prepare for ourselves and for our families, and making this, you know, just it's in our DNA to remind us, like, how do we set our lives up? Because life is really, really busy, and we can't really do life on the fly, y'all. We got to stop trying to think we can do life on the fly. So what are ways that we can, in community, do this work together, and I feel like, oh, I gotta cook all this stuff. It's like, yo, we've been doing this, you know, composting ain't new.
Right.
My grandmother called it a slop bucket. It was sitting right on there on the counter.
Right.
You put all of that and then you move back together. That communal living. Really, y'all? Now we talking about co-housing. We've been doing this. You know, we weren't set up to be in isolation. So it's just really a way, and we'll also be offering more wailing and crying sessions, both virtually and also in person.
I'll be getting a new microphone for that one because I need
Yeah, come on. We got some crying to do, y'all. We got some wailing to do. I'm here for it.
I appreciate that. All right, Dr. Joi Lewis, you are awesome, amazing, and brilliant.
And you are too, my brother.
Right,
and
well,
then how will
it takes one to know one.
What was that?
It takes one to know one.
That's right. Now, how will people be able to get the replay, or what's the business?
Oh, no, this is going to, we'll be recording right now, but this is going to go on the YouTube around the world.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. So they can check it out. All right.
And I'll be sending it to you the moment. Matter of fact, I'll give you the date when it premieres.
Okay, awesome.
And then you can take it and send it to your peeps.
Okay, sounds good. Well, thank you so much. And thank your queen for sharing time and for telling you that you needed to get me on here. Appreciate it.
Well, she didn't have to tell me. I already knew, but I, you know, of course, you know, she when she tells me something,
fine.
I gotta do that.
Right.
That's how that works. You know. So I want to live a long, prosperous, and healthy life.
That's right. Good.
You hear that, honey bunny? Okay. Yeah. So, I appreciate you, and I want you to come back. I'd love for you to come back with Resma. And
oh, that would be awesome. And you're in Sac, right?
Yeah, Sacramento.
Yeah, so I'll be in Oakland the 28th, March 28th through, I think, the 7th. So I'll be doing some events out there.
Is that some work with Stefan Clark?
No. Mm-mm.
Because Marianne Williamson, who's running for president, she's going to be out here as well doing some stuff with on criminal justice reform on behalf of Stephon Clark.
Oh, I have to look to see if it overlaps.
Like, what's going on the 28th?
I fly in on the 28th, so I have to see if there's any overlap. Yeah.
Okay. Well, you got my information. Let me know, and we can figure out how to hook up.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. Take good care.
All right, Queen. I appreciate you.
All right. Bye.
Okay.